Hi folks, and welcome back to Conveyancing. This is the video series on special conditions. And in this unit, we have been focusing particularly on the standard terms and conditions that you find in the REIQ standard form contracts, particularly the houses and land contract. Often, even though you will be dealing with standard form contracts, there will be one or more clauses that the buyer and seller wish to negotiate bespoke, that is, not part of the standard terms and conditions, that will deal with specific arrangements that they need to make in relation to the transaction. If that is the case, then you will be drafting up special conditions for your client to abide by, perform, and possibly enforce. And because of that, you will need to know all about the legal ins and outs of such conditions well before you draft them. Today, what we will need to look at is the classification of special conditions, and that should be a bit of revision from your contract law days. We'll be talking about conditions precedent, conditions subsequent, and the effect that that has on how the court views those conditions. We'll be looking at issues of construction. We'll be looking at the obligations that are bound up in special conditions, so best endeavours as opposed to reasonable endeavours and so on. Rights to avoid the contract in reliance on the non-fulfilment of a special condition, and the issue of waiver, when and how you can waive the benefit of a special condition. Lastly, there's a few examples that I'll just list out for you. You can go and flesh those out for yourselves in the text in a little bit more detail. So that's the overview of what we've got on the menu for today. So looking first at the issue of classification. All right, so thinking back to your contract law days, where we are looking at terms and what it is that they do, you might describe a term as a condition precedent or a condition subsequent, or in fact you may preface your entire agreement by saying that it is subject to formal contract. So what we need to do is just unpack all of those terms right now. Firstly, we'll just look at general principles around them, and then we'll look at the effect of conditions precedent, conditions subsequent, and when you actually specify that your entire agreement is subject to contract. Generally speaking, the terminology here can get a little bit confusing. And you'll see, you know, the text talks about the High Court saying basically all of this kind of classification attempt is a bit meaningless, and you'll see why. A special condition can either suspend formation of the contract, and that's normally where we talk about conditions precedent, or it could suspend performance of the contract, so we normally call those conditions subsequent. However, you can see that equally, a condition that suspends performance of the contract might also be called a condition precedent to performance. So, you know, you've had all of this different terminology being used. The upshot is you really just need to make it clear what it is that the condition actually does. Does it stop or prevent the whole agreement coming into force? Does it prevent formation? In which case, then, generally speaking, we're going to be calling that a condition precedent, or does it just, you know, suspend or delay the party's performance of a contract that is immediately binding? We tend to call those conditions subsequent. Just be mindful that the main thing is you need to know what it is that it does. Most conditions, by far and away, the vast bulk of special conditions, so, as I said, finance, approvals, consent of a lessor to assignment, that kind of thing, don't prevent formation of a contract itself. Okay, the parties will be in a contractual relationship. They will usually be conditions subsequent. As I say, they're in yellow. However, it may well be that if you preface your agreement with words like subject to contract, you may find that there is no binding agreement that is formed unless and until the parties go ahead and execute that formal contract. That might not be the result that your client wants, so you need to be pretty careful about when you do label things subject to contract and what you intend to achieve by labeling it subject to contract. So terminology can get a little bit confusing. The main thing is to just know what the clause is, you know, what it intends to do for your client. Okay, so looking at the effect of special conditions, as I said, the three common ones that we need to talk about: precedent, subsequent, subject to contract. A condition precedent, obviously, unless and until the event that is specified in the condition occurs, then there is going to be no contract at all that is formed between the parties. A condition precedent might well relate to just part of the contract. It may relate to the whole contract itself. So just because you've got a condition precedent that actually does prevent contractual formation, it might just be for a specific part or a specific condition. Not usually within the power of the parties to cause the event to happen. Condition precedents are usually dependent on third-party decision-making or intervention. They're usually inserted for the benefit of both parties, and these little beasties can't be waived by either party. And if you think about it, it's pretty obvious why. Essentially, there's no legally binding rights to enforce or to waive at this point until the condition itself has been fulfilled and the contract has been formed. So until that happens, there's really nothing to waive, is there, on the books? So waiver is not really so relevant to conditions precedent. If a condition precedent is unfulfilled because the contract has never actually ripened into a legally binding agreement, the deposit's going to have to be returned. Now, I put deposit in quotes down there on the second last bullet point because it's not really a deposit, is it? There's no contract that's been formed, and therefore your deposit is your earnest of performance, isn't it? It's your promise to perform the conditions in the contract. Because there's no contract, there's no real deposit, it's just the money that's being held in the hope that it will ripen into a true deposit once a legally binding agreement has come on foot. If there's no date for performance of a condition precedent, then the latest possible time for performance will be the date of settlement. So that is your condition precedent. Now, conditions subsequent, as I said before, these are the vast bulk of special conditions that you will see. The parties will have entered a legally binding agreement. It's just that performance will be suspended until whatever event it is that's specified in the condition subsequent actually comes to pass or not. Okay, again, much like we said with conditions precedent, it might relate to a whole of the contract, part of the contract. The main thing to note is that contract rights are in existence here. However, they are going to be voidable if the condition subsequent is unfulfilled at the option of the party that's innocent, okay, not responsible for non-fulfillment of the condition. Conditions subsequent can be waived, so a little bit of a difference there from conditions precedent. We'll unpack that a bit later in this video series. If there's no time specified for fulfillment of the special condition, which is a condition subsequent, the latest time will be settlement or within a reasonable time. If by settlement the buyer doesn't actually rely on non-fulfillment to avoid the contract, then they are going to be bound to perform. They'll be locked in and there'll be no further discretions really allowed, so performance will be required. In terms of being subject to formal contract, if you think back to your contract law days, you will recall a case that we did called Masters and Cameron. And in that case, the High Court teased out three different categories of circumstance in which the words subject to formal contract might be used. But in each of these different circumstances, there were different factual arrangements between the parties. So I guess the point is that just using the word subject to formal contract has no necessary implication that one of these categories will apply. So the first one, the first category was where parties have reached final agreement, they intend to be immediately bound, and they expect that each other will go ahead and perform the terms, but they just want them restated in a formal contract. The second category is where parties have reached final agreement, but they intend to make performance of a term or more terms conditional on execution of that formal contract. In both of these circumstances, the text suggests, and I would agree, they're fairly uncommon, because usually where you're using the words subject to formal contract, it tends to indicate that the parties haven't quite finished their negotiations yet. And so you wouldn't normally have the parties having to be immediately bound, and in the first case having to perform the terms, or in the second case having to just make certain terms conditional on execution of a formal contract, as you know the authors of the text say. Particularly where solicitors are involved, normally you'll have the formal written contract happening at the end of the negotiations, so normally it wouldn't be that the parties would expect to be bound until the end of that negotiation period, where everyone's happy with all the terms and they've all been bedded down, and then the contract happens. So it's not often that these things proceed on a wink and a nod or a smile or a handshake, and the parties just go ahead and do things, making it all then subject to the contract happening, written contract happening down the track. Normally it will be something like category three, where parties intend no formal concluded agreement unless and until that formal contract has been signed by both parties. Often this will happen where a buyer wants to complete some further investigations on the property. That kind of stipulation can only really be waived by both parties together, although we'll discuss waiver, as I said, in just a minute. So that's category three. Now that's where Masters and Cameron left things. However, there's been a further line of cases that suggest that there may be a fourth category of circumstance where subject to contract is used. And in this fourth category, it's said that the parties have reached final agreement, they intend to be bound immediately by the terms, so something like categories one and two, but they expect to make a further contract in substitution for the first contract, possibly containing further terms, additional terms, by consent between the parties. Okay, now if those additional terms are actually agreed by the parties, then they're going to be added to the whole corpus of the formal agreement. This kind of thing tends to occur where you have heads of agreement that have been reached by the parties. And so there's your four categories. And as I said, the first two, not terribly common. The third one is really the prima facie natural meaning of subject to formal contract. Heads of agreement are a little bit of a grey area, and if you want a refresher on heads of agreement, I would suggest that you go back and have a look at your contract law texts. But that's your suggested fourth category there. What I've done here is I've made you a little table, because it does get a little bit confusing with these categories, to kind of show you at a glance the effect of any given circumstance falling into category 1, 2, 3 or 4, and hopefully that should help you working out what the whole Masters and Cameron thing is all about. As I said, usually the natural meaning of the words subject to formal contract will be category three or class three, as I say there. And I'll pop that up on Moodle for you. Very helpfully, Justice Temblin in the Francis and New South Wales Egg Producers Co-op case collected together a stack of useful principles when you're trying to work out what exactly the parties meant by subject to formal contract and how far along the negotiation process they were and whether they intended to be immediately bound by this contract that has subject to formal contract on it. Eminently sensible principles there. The text sets them out at length, but you can summarise them fairly quickly. All very good common sense tips, really, as to how a court is going to work out what the parties intended by this kind of thing. Obviously, a central question here is, what did the parties intend? Did they intend a concluded bargain or not? As I've just finished saying, subject to contract really is going to prima facie mean that no binding contract has been concluded between the parties. You're just fleshing out the terms as a basis or a foundation for the future contract that will then become binding once it's all executed. There's no special formula of words. Importantly, parole evidence may be relied on in order to work out exactly what the parties intended, including subsequent conduct between the parties. Subjective intent is not controlling, that's for sure, as usually is the case in matters of contract investigation. The objective construction of language used by the parties, as well as the nature, subject matter, complexity of the contract, timing and any urgency between the parties, all of that kind of thing is going to hold sway. However, in this particular investigation, subjective intent certainly can be taken into account, but as I've said there, and as they said in the Francis case, it's certainly not going to be controlling. It's just one of the things that's taken into the factual matrix as a whole when trying to work out what the parties intended here and whether they were actually had locked themselves into something legally binding that they have to now perform, or whether it was going to be put off until everything was signed in written form. Certainly if significant items are yet to be agreed, so if there's two of the three P's missing, price, party, property, then you know there's going to be no concluded bargain, therefore nothing that is going to compel the parties to perform at this point. Anyway, so that's the issue of subject to contract. These are the general principles that will apply when you're talking about subject to contract, conditions precedent, and conditions subsequent. Alrighty, so that's classification of terms. So we've passed the 15-minute mark now. I think I'll wrap it up here, and I will see you all in video 2 for an examination of construction, obligations, avoidance, and waiver. Until then, bye for now, guys.